Hi everybody. In the previous video, we looked at the molecular orbital diagrams of homonuclear diatomic molecules. In this video, we'll extend those ideas to see what happens when the two atoms in the molecule are different from each other. In a heteronuclear diatomic molecule, most of what we learned in the previous video still applies. There are really only a couple of key differences that we need to keep in mind between homonuclear and heteronuclear diatomics. First, when the two atoms in the molecule are different from each other, their atomic orbitals start at different energies. Specifically, the more electronegative element starts lower in energy. Hopefully you remember from general chemistry that electronegativity is basically how strongly an element pulls on the electrons in a bond. Excluding the noble gases, electronegativity increases as you move to the upper right corner of the periodic table, so fluorine is the most electronegative element. When an element is electronegative and it pulls strongly on electrons, it's putting those electrons in more stable or lower energy orbitals. We can see this in the molecular orbital diagram of carbon monoxide. We're going to draw this MO diagram with carbon on the left and oxygen on the right. Because oxygen is more electronegative than carbon, its atomic orbitals start lower in energy. As usual, we're going to allow the atomic orbitals to interact in pairs, with a pair of atomic orbitals forming a bonding orbital that's lower in energy and an anti-bonding orbital that's higher in energy. So the 2s orbitals interact, the 2p orbitals of sigma symmetry interact, and the 2p orbitals of pi symmetry interact. The overall picture looks mostly the same as what we saw for homonuclear diatomic molecules, with just a couple of things to notice. First of all, notice that the pi bonding orbitals consisting of 2p are lower in energy than the sigma bonding orbital. This is something that we actually saw in the previous video for diatomic nitrogen. When one or both of the elements are relatively far to the left in the periodic table, these pi bonding orbitals tend to be lower than sigma. Also, notice the way that I've named the molecular orbitals. I no longer refer to them as g or u. Because it's a heteronuclear diatomic molecule and it's no longer symmetric from end to end, the orbitals are not truly even or odd. So instead, I name them things like sigma and sigma star and refer to the atomic orbitals that they came from. We'll see the asymmetry of these orbitals in pictures in just a minute. Now we're ready to fill in the electrons. The carbon atom brings with it 4 valence electrons and the oxygen atom brings 6. So we put the electrons on the sides of the MO diagram for bookkeeping purposes. And the important thing is that we fill in the 10 total electrons in the middle, from lowest energy to highest energy. I'll give you a few seconds to use this MO diagram to think about what the bond order of carbon monoxide is, and whether or not that bond order matches what you expect from the Lewis structure. Looking in the middle of the diagram, you can see that there are 8 bonding electrons and 2 antibonding electrons. That means the bond order is 1/2 times 8 minus 2, or 3. It's a triple bond. If you draw a Lewis structure of carbon monoxide and follow the octet rule, you'll see that the only way to make it work is to draw a triple bond between carbon and oxygen. The other important way that molecular orbitals change when the two atoms in a diatomic molecule are different is that the molecular orbitals are no longer split exactly 50-50 between the two atoms. When the two atoms are the same, an electron in the bonding or the antibonding orbital is equally likely to be on the atom on the left or the atom on the right. But when the two atoms are different, an orbital can be weighted one way or the other. The thing to remember is that a bonding orbital has more weight on the more electronegative atom, and an antibonding orbital has more weight on the less electronegative atom. This kind of makes sense. The bonding orbital is lower in energy, so it more closely resembles the atomic orbital that's lower in energy, the one on the more electronegative atom. And the antibonding orbital is higher in energy, so it more closely resembles the atomic orbital that's higher in energy, the one on the less electronegative atom. Even though this makes intuitive sense, it would be nice if we could show it mathematically, starting with the Schrödinger equation. And that's what we're going to do now. In the next few slides, we're going to think about two normalized atomic orbitals mixing with each other to form a bonding and an antibonding orbital. We'll call the atomic orbitals capital A and capital B. Maybe they're identical to each other, maybe they're not. As we've seen, molecular orbitals can be expressed as linear combinations, sums and differences of atomic orbitals. So we'll say that a molecular orbital psi is equal to a coefficient CA times orbital A plus a different coefficient CB times orbital B. What we're going to do here is set up a system of equations that allow us to solve for the unknowns. The unknowns are CA, CB, and the molecular orbital energies. On this slide, there's going to be a fair amount of math that comes pretty quickly, but what's most important is to have a qualitative understanding of where these equations are coming from. We'll start with the Schrödinger equation itself. In its simplest form, the Schrödinger equation is H psi equals E psi. Since we've said the molecular orbitals can be expressed as linear combinations of atomic orbitals, I'll start with the Schrödinger equation with the molecular orbitals written out. This next step might seem to come out of nowhere. We have an equation where the two sides are equal to each other, and if we do the same thing to both sides of the equation, they'll still be equal. So I'm going to take the Schrödinger equation, front multiply each side by orbital A, and integrate over all space. Again, this seems like kind of an arbitrary step, but if the two sides were equal before, they're still equal. In this equation, the coefficients C and the energy E are constants, so they can come out of the integrals. So I'm going to take the C's and E out of the integrals, I'm going to do some distributing, and end up with this expanded form of the equation. As you can see, there are several different integrals in this equation, so we're going to think about them one by one. In principle, we can find the values of those integrals, but really all we need to do in this situation is think about them and give them names. The two integrals on the right side of the equation are things that we've seen before. The integral of the normalized atomic orbital A squared, by definition, is equal to 1. That's what it means to be normalized. And the integral of orbital A times orbital B is what we've previously defined as capital S, the overlap integral. It's a measure of how much those two orbitals overlap in space. The two integrals on the left side of the equation are things that we haven't seen before. The integral of an atomic orbital times the Hamiltonian applied to that same orbital is what's called the Coulomb integral. We're going to give it the symbol alpha A, and we can think of it as basically the atomic orbital energy of orbital A. Next, we have the integral of an atomic orbital times the Hamiltonian applied to a different atomic orbital. This is what's called a resonance integral. We'll give it the symbol beta, and it's essentially a measure of how much the energies of those atomic orbitals interact. It's related to the overlap integral, but it has units of energy. Now that we've given all of these integrals values or symbols, we can write a more compact form of this equation. And I'm going to take one more mathematical step and combine the terms that have CA and the terms that have CB. So let's think about this equation. The alphas and betas have values that could in principle be calculated. The unknowns are CA, CB, and E, so we have an equation that relates these unknowns to each other. As you probably remember from a math class, if we have three unknowns, one equation is not enough, so we need to think about other equations that allow us to relate these unknowns to each other. Remember, to find this first equation, we took the kind of arbitrary step of multiplying the Schrödinger equation by A on both sides and integrating. We could just as easily have done the same thing with B. And that's what we're going to do to find our second equation. We won't actually go through all of these steps again, but you could imagine going through all of these steps just by multiplying both sides of the Schrödinger equation by B. If we did that, we would get the following equation. If we want to solve for three unknowns, CA, CB, and E, we probably need three equations. So far we have two of them, which we got by multiplying the Schrödinger equation by A and then B. These two equations are called the secular equations, and there are two of them because we're allowing two atomic orbitals to interact. The third equation is one that we've seen before, and I'll give you a few seconds to see if you can figure out what it is. The third equation is actually a normalization condition. If we require that our molecular orbitals are normalized, we have a third equation that relates the unknowns to each other. So, we have three equations and three unknowns, and we're actually in a position to solve them. Notice that the third equation is quadratic, so it actually turns out that there's more than one possible set of solutions to these equations, And that's good, because we know there's more than one possible molecular orbital. So on the next slide, we'll plug in some realistic numbers for the alphas and betas and the overlap integral, and we'll see how the unknowns come out. Throughout the calculations on this slide, I'm going to assume the overlap integral S is equal to 0.2. This is a pretty typical value for two atoms at a realistic bond distance. I'm also going to assume that the resonance integral beta is equal to negative 1. The resonance integral is typically negative. I've chosen the value negative 1 arbitrarily, but since I haven't really given it units anyway, it doesn't really matter. Next, I'm going to choose several different values for the atomic orbital energies alpha A and alpha B and see how the unknowns come out. If alpha A and alpha B are equal to each other, these pictures show the molecular orbitals and their energies. In these pictures, blue and green represent positive and negative signs of the wave function, and the sizes of the circles represent the magnitudes of CA and CB. So when the two atomic orbitals have the same energy, we have a bonding orbital that's lower in energy and has two equal lobes on the two atoms, and an antibonding orbital that's higher in energy that has two equal and opposite lobes on the two atoms. This is what we expect for a homonuclear diatomic molecule. But when we allow the two atomic orbitals to start at different energies, something slightly different happens. In this case, orbital A is lower in energy than orbital B, so we have a bonding orbital that's weighted more toward orbital A, and an antibonding orbital that's weighted more toward orbital B. And the more different the two energies of the atomic orbitals are, the more skewed the molecular orbitals are. This gives us a qualitative sense of how molecular orbitals are affected by the starting energies of the atomic orbitals. Finally, I'd just like to sum up the key points from this video. We've focused on two main differences between the molecular orbital diagrams of heteronuclear and homonuclear diatomics. First, for a heteronuclear diatomic, the atomic orbitals on the two atoms start at different energies, with the more electronegative element having the lower energy atomic orbitals. And second, the molecular orbitals in a heteronuclear diatomic are no longer split 50-50. The bonding orbitals are weighted more on the more electronegative element, and the antibonding orbitals are weighted more on the less electronegative element. That's all for now. In the next video, we'll think about how to extend these ideas to larger polyatomic molecules.